Hey, this is Wes with Missouri Wind and Solar. We're coming to you from the classroom today. If you're interested in attending any of our classes, check out our website, windandsolar.com, and you'll see a classroom link up at the top, where you can click on that and see all the available classes that we've got going on. But today we want to talk with you and go through alternative energy basics. There's three things that we want to address regardless of what type of configuration you go with. And those three things, just to begin with, are our key. One is to own your own equipment. There's a lot of companies out there that are doing particular solar energy these days, and really what they're selling is leasing. I grew up in the 80s, and my parents and even myself got into where cars were being leased, and I know probably some of the folks watching our video today know how that worked. You leased a car, and then when you went to turn it in, you got hit with these ridiculous fees, and you never owned the car, and then you got hit with all these fees at the end. Be very careful about what deal you're getting into, and just make sure you own your own equipment. The other thing you want to do is know your local codes. We can talk about anything you want and how to configure this. It doesn't matter if your local codes don't permit this. And so even though we're going to sell you stuff that's UL listed and all these good things, it still may not be permissible under your codes. So know your codes that you're dealing with. You also need to know what your power company will allow you to do. So be sure and do your research before you make your first purchase. Last thing on here that we're going to look at is almost anything that you buy. We always get asked, how much does it cost? What's it going to take? All those type of things. Cost is one of the major components. What you basically want to do is look at an 8-year payback on anything you buy. So anything that you purchase, particularly if you're going grid tied, it's going to take 8 years to pay it back. So if you bought one solar panel and one GTI, you know, it would take you 8 years to pay that back, even if you just bought one versus if you bought 30. It doesn't change, there's 8 years. And to go off grid, we would typically talk about looking at your power bill and doing some multiples of there. So there's some quick math that we can do that'll get you in the ballpark. So regardless of what you're looking at, those are some basic numbers that you can look at to begin with. So let's move on and talk about the two main divisions in how you get into alternative energy. So the first item that we're going to talk about, really probably the easiest, is just off-grid, because it is exactly that. You're not connected to the power system. You're not connected to the grid. And you may have solar, you may have wind, you may have hydro, but basically, you are doing your power generation. So you're going to have equipment that creates the power, again, a solar panel, a wind turbine, those type of things. And then you're going to have a way of storing that. So you're going to have batteries. Now, a lot of videos and a lot of research that you'll do out there will really talk down about batteries and how challenging it is and battery maintenance and all those things. I have to tell you, battery technology has come so far just in the last few years that battery maintenance really should not be any kind of keeping you from entering into getting your own energy system. Some of these battery systems are almost to the point where it's set it and forget it. So, and again, in the off-grid scenario, it's really pretty simple. You're not connected. And again, you still need to check your local codes. Some situations will not allow you to have a occupancy permit. Some will not allow you to have health or have a homeowner's insurance. So you need to check that. But off-grid is very simple to take a look at. So our second one method we're going to look at is grid-tied, and a subcomponent of that, which is grid-tied with batteries. So in our grid-tied scenario, you are kind of taking the grid, pulling in from your alternative energy source, whether that be wind or solar, and basically you're just netting out your energy use. That's typically what we see in a lot of the big housing developments and stuff like that. And what's happening is you're generating power. It is being consumed typically in your home. If there's any left over, it's being netted back into the grid. And so there's been some question about, well, where does it go? Probably goes into your neighbor's house. The big thing here is if the grid goes down, you go down. There's a few units that you can buy that do have some ability to get some power out of them, but that's few and far between. But the big thing with grid tied is that you're really dependent on that system. And there's a key element of that is that when you're grid tied like this, the power company wants to protect their linemen. This is a huge thing. So they want to know that the equipment that you've got is not backfeeding into the web when they have a power outage, so that when that lineman goes out there to fix the power line, he grabs what he assumes to be a dead side of the power line. They need to know that that really is dead. And so there's a lot of checking that the power company is going to want to do if you're grid tied to make sure that your system complies with that. Now, off of grid tied, you have a variant of that that's grid tied with batteries. And a typical unit that most of us carry is an Outback Radian. And what that does is it kind of best of both worlds there. And so what that does is you are grid tied, so you're pulling from the grid as you need, but you're also storing backup energy in batteries. So this is a battery system. And what happens is, when the grid goes down, your controller senses that happening and switches to using power from the batteries. The key to this is that you need to make sure that you have a sub-panel in that system that's only carrying your critical loads. And you have to think about it from the standpoint of if you're in Florida, you're running your air conditioning unit. Well, if you only have a few batteries, and your system starts trying to pull enough energy from your batteries to run your air conditioning system, those batteries are going to last for about 20 seconds. And so what you want to do is have a different sub-panel where you have critical loads that are then wired into this situation. And so it'd be stuff like your refrigerator, something if you had a medical device like a CPAP or something like that, and things that you need to make sure that you have power while you bridge this time period while they're getting the grid back up. And so this is really kind of the best of both worlds. And then what it also does, one of the nice things about this, is this can be kind of your pathway into even moving into the off-grid scenario. So you can grow this system, growing your battery backup. And again, this is just a math problem of how many batteries do you want, which gives you how many days of autonomy that you want in being able to be without power. So that's really just kind of a quick overview of what those differences are. If you need more in-depth help with this, you need to get into some specific components that you need to look at or want to start putting together a system, just reach out to our sales team here at Missouri Wind and Solar, and our guys will be able to get really into the details with you and help you make some very good decisions.